How many dopamine receptors are there? Well, you could say there's two and there's five. There's actually two classes. There's five individuals. So we say there's the one class called D1-like, which is D1 and 5, and D2-like, which are the other ones. And if you look at this carefully, you'll see that the D1 are excitatory. They stimulate. And on the right, the D2-like are inhibitory, and they stop stimulation. So this is interesting. You can have dopamine, and you can turn something on or something off with the same neurotransmitter, just depending what receptor is there. That's kind of handy. You can do two things with the same neurotransmitter, in fact, the opposite things. So there are presynaptic and there are postsynaptic neurons. Shown here on the left is a presynaptic D2 receptor, and on the bottom, D1, 2, 3, 4, 5. On the right, there's a presynaptic D3 receptor, and on the bottom, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If you're really astute, can you tell the difference between the left one and the right one besides that? Yeah, there's more blue dopamine on the left than there is on the right. Now, what does D2 on the presynaptic do for a living? It detects dopamine in the synapse, and when it raises to a certain level, it shuts off more release. So you don't have too much dopamine. On the right, it's showing you that the D3 receptor must be much more sensitive than the D2 because it's not letting as much dopamine accumulate. And indeed, that is the case. The D3 receptor is very sensitive to dopamine. So if you want a lot of dopamine in your synapse, you do the one on the, you manufacture your D2 presynaptic receptor, and you put that one on your neuron. If you want it to actually have less, you put the D3 on the one. That's the way the brain's organized. So you have gatekeepers. These are, again, ion channels that make sure that you open or close the release of neurotransmitters. And if you put a D2 or D3 receptor, remember they're inhibitory, this will stop more release. So I'm going to show it another way. Here's your presynaptic D2 or D3, and you have your blue neuron firing with blue dopamine coming out, and now one of those pieces of dopamine has gotten into the presynaptic receptor, put up the gate, and stopped further release. So that's called presynaptic inhibition. There's also a dopamine 2 and dopamine 3 receptor on the other end, on the far left of that same neuron where we showed it just in the previous one on the far right. And the same thing happens there. If D2 or D3 gets dopamine into it, whoop, boom, there goes into it. What's going to happen to the lightning there? It goes down. And what's going to happen to the blue dopamine on the far right? It goes down. So again, whenever there's a presynaptic D2 or D3 receptor, whether it's on the far right or on the far left, if dopamine is detected, it will stop because it's inhibitory. Further release. Another way to look at this is that the ventral tegmental area, VTA, on the left is the home and headquarters for a bunch of dopamine neurons. The substantia nigra on the right is another place where a bunch of dopamine neurons live. You're looking here about neurons that go from the VTA to the cortex on the left, and on the right, they go from the VTA and the substantia nigra up into the striatum. Why do you care? Because there's a lot of differences. You have the same dopamine, but look how different things are. On the left, you either have D2 or D3 presynaptic receptors, and they go up into the prefrontal cortex. How come that blue circle is so big up there? Well, Dr. Stahl, didn't you just tell us in the previous slide that there's no dopamine transporter to suck it up? Right, because if you look at the ends of those neurons on the left and the ends of the neurons on the right, the one on the left doesn't have any D2 or D3 receptors or a dopamine transporter there. That means they're wild, ready to actually go crazy and have a lot more release onto those D1 receptors up in the PFC, prefrontal cortex. On the right, interestingly enough, one of the neurons has D3 receptors on the end of it, and the other one has D2. And just in I just showed you this in another neuron. D2 is less sensitive, so it does let the dopamine build up, so there's more of a cloud of dopamine on the right than on the left. And there's dopamine transporters on both of those. So you begin to see that you can have dopamine, same neurotransmitter, it can do wildly different things in different parts of the brain, depending upon what the projections are and what the receptors are. So where are these projections? There is one from the substantia nigra up into the striatum, nigrostriatal pathway, and what is that one? What illness does this die in? That pathway dies in Parkinson's disease, right? And if you block it, it causes drug-induced Parkinsonism. Here is the thalamic pathway, which may be involved with alertness. It's not as well characterized. Here is a mesolimbic pathway, which is too high in what illness? Basically, psychosis of any illness. It's been shown even in human PET scans that the end of that neuron I just showed you is releasing a whole bunch of dopamine. You end up having one that goes to the cortex. This is mesocortical. We'll talk about that later. And then finally, the tuberoinfundibular pathway here, which actually regulates prolactin. So here's the tuberoinfundibular pathway. Here's the nigrostriatal pathway. And if the nigrostriatal pathway is shown at the bottom going to the first box on the bottom, the reality is that this is controlling motor, and I'm going to acquaint you with a new term called CSTC loops. Cortical at the top box, thalamic at the middle box, striatal at the lower box, back to cortex, CSTC. And so what ends up happening is that these neurons go around and around and around. C down to S, S to T, T to C. This is a cortical engine. This is how you think. When you're thinking, your nervous neurotransmission is talking to it other than thinking and categorizing and, you know, getting the memories out and deciding what to do, or something like a motor movement. I have to move my fingers. So you have to block some things and stimulate other things and stabilize other things. How do you suppose that's done? Well, it's done by these CSTC loops, and substantia nigra comes into the striatum. Now let's look at the substrate for motor movements and dopamine. So on the left, you have a bunch of neurons coming up to the top, and you see in the bottom at the box where it says D1, the D1 receptor is regulating these guys on the left. And since it goes from the striatum all the way to the globus pallidus, it's called direct, and it's D1. On the right, you've got D2, and it's going through two other boxes before it gets to the globus pallidus. Therefore, it's called indirect. And these things working together balance motor output at the top. So they decide whether you move or you don't move. And it does it for every little muscle fiber. Dopamine is stimulatory. Remember I told you that? So the D1 pathway says to the go pathway, go mow, go mow, go mow. And so the D1 stimulates output. Funny enough, the D2 pathway stimulates output in a different way. It says, don't stop. Same thing as saying, please go. So over here, it inhibits stop. If it's inhibiting stop, stop doesn't stop. And then stop means, oh, am I going to stop? The opposite of that's to go. So in both cases, dopamine is a pro-movement neurotransmitter through both pathways. And some of that's good if you are trying to help a condition that's slow, like Parkinson's disease, but some of it's bad if you're already going too fast, like in tardive dyskinesia.